I'm not. I have no relations to text.
Influential times
zero relations to Texas.
Okay, I'm just checking.
I don't have a cat, a fish, a dog, and I have no relations to Texas.
You got no family live in Texas?
That's not. I have no relations.
Do you have family that lives in Texas?
I have people who reside in Texas. I have
that no are your family.
I have no relations to the state of Texas.
Where does your mom live?
She resides in the state of Texas.
That is the greatest lawyer move. Of, do you know anybody who lives in Texas? I know people who reside.
Welcome to Boyd and 10 right here on Spreaker, iTunes, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Google Podcasts, Amazon Podcasts, wherever you're listening. If you're not on any of the big boys, if you're holding it together, who? Maybe if you just put a satellite in your backyard and you're pulling it into your Walkman because you're handy. Thank you. We appreciate it. We're in your ear. So, all right. Three comedians, 10 topics, one podcast. The unofficial podcast of.
I mean, ran into a verbal brick wall, didn't he? All right. Just like that you put in front of yourself.
Let's just, we're going to take a left hand.
Boy,
the unofficial podcast of the YouTube comment section of my special neighbor and human, available right now on YouTube and all over all other streaming platforms. So check it out right now. My name's Nathan Owens. I probably should have said that first.
Maybe.
My name is Nathan Owens. You can find me on Twitter at @IAM_Owens. Instagram, I'm Owens. NathanOwensComedy.com. David Perdue's with me.
What's up, good people? It's me, David Perdue. I'm going to pull a Damon and tell you where I'm going to be at up top. This week, I'm going to be at Buteco here in Atlanta in Grant Park with my man, Don Bean, for Good Night. And then I'll also be at the Laughing Skull Lounge this Friday and Saturday. And yeah, you can follow me on Instagram and Twitter at Do or Die. It's at DUEORDIE or DavidPerdueComedy.com.
And of course, Damon Sumner.
What's going on, good people? Get at me on Instagram, TikTok, DAMONJR2.
No Dan Dungan this week because he's on the island.
Is he?
Yeah, he's back on the island. Island Dan is in full effect.
When you say island, like, you have the prior listeners. Like, it's not his island, is it?
No. No,
it's we don't
not,
know.
It's not, no, it is not like the Duncan Island.
We don't know.
I feel weird like giving away people's location, but I mean, it's a big place.
No, I'm just, it's fine.
Is that weird?
No, you're doing right.
This is the beach Dan goes to?
See, when you normally you say beach, right? Normally I hear you say Dan's the beach. Island. When you said island, I think like, oh, man, I was doing real good. He ain't got himself an island.
I thought we called him Island Dan.
Nah, island on was Beach Dan. You know him as Island Dan, Damon?
Yeah, listen, I barely know what he looked like, so I don't know. Like,
that's true.
I couldn't tell you about his whereabouts. What I do know is that you should be rocking with us over on Patreon for exclusive content. Patreon.com/4010. We just got into a dope pre-show audio episode you don't want to miss out on. For as little as four quarters, people, just a few pieces of change, you can get extra content coming your way every single week. We got the exclusive Slack channel, we get in, we have a good time, so many other great things. Check us out over on Patreon.
Well, there we go. You already jump into it?
Let's go to work.
Let's get it.
All right, let's talk NBA playoffs. I believe that's the biggest story in the sports world today. Let's go ahead and get these out of the way. Western Conference Finals. As we record this on Monday night, it is a 3-0 Golden State lead. I believe Dan is the only one who picked Golden State in a sweep.
Oh, I'm about to say in a sweep.
I believe we all picked Golden State.
Okay.
I think I said five, but anywhere between five and seven. Dan picked them in a sweep.
Wow.
He's looking correct.
Correct, and I'm not mad at it.
Nah, I think Luka will get one. I think Luka.
Luka. It's about everybody else.
I agree. Here's the only reason I think Luka will get one combining with Golden State will give up one. Like they will go on stretch because they know they can win. Hopefully they don't do this, but we've seen them do in the past play terrible basketball by turning the ball over too much, run it like just bad offense. You know, you can miss shots and then kind of be like, man, we'll turn on the fourth. And then it might not always be a fourth that you can turn it on. That's, I just I feel the same way about Luka, the same way I feel about Trey. If you let them hang around in the fourth, they can still win.
Yeah.
Now that being said, likelihood of this, I got a less than 30% chance. But I, when it comes to people being great, I think Luka is one of the greats, and so I feel like he can get him one. He in a combination with the Warriors can get him one. I don't think that's happening, but I think it's possible.
I think I think I hear that and I respect that there. That 30% less chance is a valid number. I think the boys gonna come out ready to go. I think they're gonna smell that blood, they're gonna see those heads down, and they're gonna wanna end it. So when they get back to San Fran, they trying to be in their bed chilling. They hoping for the Eastern Conference to go 7 games, rest up Payne second, rest up Otto Porter Jr., rest up Iguodala, right? Rest everybody up as long as they can. And so I think, correct me if I'm wrong, I feel like they swept Portland. When Portland was in the Western Conference Finals, they swept them. Maybe it was 2019 as well. I always feel when
Portland is in the playoffs.
And when they were in the Western Conference Finals. I'm pretty sure that was they got swept by Warriors. So I expect the Warriors to come out blazing. I expect the Mavs to come out blazing. But I think the Warriors are going to be too much.
Yeah, I can see the Warriors taking a night off, but I can also see them, like Damon said, just being like, let's just get it done. Let's go home. Like, let's go hang out. Let's rest. Let's get ready for whoever's coming up. Who, if we're judging by the game that's heading going on right now, I believe Boston's not struggling.
It's going to be 2-2 going back to Miami, and we'll get to that in a little bit. So,
I will say nothing to add to my point. It's not like I'm making this up. If we recall, they was down by almost 50 the last round against Memphis.
They were down
like,
by 55.
Like, this is not like me making this up.
No.
They do this. No, I'm not saying y'all are saying. I'm just saying for full context for our listeners. Like, they absolutely do this. It's a lot of being too good.
A lot of teams do it. And, like, especially, like, our Popovich will do it every once in a while. Like, when he had those teams, especially if you start getting down, there's certain coaches, I think, pull the cord when it's not going well. And they're just like, all right, we're down by 25 in the third quarter. Like, well, that's it. Like, starters are on the bench. Get everybody else in there. We'll lose by 50. It doesn't matter. Like, margin of victory is not a thing in these series. So, I completely get it. I think if they come out flat, we will see that. I don't think they'll plan to do that. But I think if they come out and Dallas starts on, like, a 15-2 run, that's when they'll just, like,
no,
I think we're good.
No, they're not doing it in the first quarter. It's going to be a second half decision.
Yeah,
it's not going to be.
You got to barely beat the Warriors in third quarter. They're a third quarter team, so you don't beat them in the third. It's a wrap city.
Yeah, they know they can come back. Yeah, they have too many. Like I was watching a game like last night. It's just like, who do you imagine? Like the fact that like, all right, what does Steph go for? 30?
32, 31, 31 and 11.
Like Wiggins went for what? 27? A very quiet.
27 and 11.
Like, very quiet. Until the dunk, a very quiet 27. Until the dunk. Right? Right? Klay Thompson is sitting around with like just a few shots, 19 points. One of the greatest shooters of all time. Like, I got 19. Like, there's no stopping. Jordan Poole had 10. He'd been averaging 20 plus the whole. Like, what do you do? What do you do?
Looney out here dropping career highs.
And then grabbing the rebounds and playing defense on every like
this.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is what I want to say, though. This is so narratives pop up and certain narratives bother me because of timing. And the narrative of Luka needs help. Luka needs help is now a storyline is popping up more. This is what we're not going to do. We're not going to praise and highlight players who helped get out of a 2-0 hole in Utah and then beat the number one seed in Phoenix in 7 games and then come up to a formidable opponent and act like they trash. These are the same fellas. These are the same dogs. These are the same men who people were out here praising. Look at the social media, sports media journalists. A lot of people were having the Mavs win this series. So what you can't do, in my strong opinion, is begin to create a narrative when people are down that had a lot of praise, but didn't try to flip it. These are the same dogs who came out of the Utah hole, same dogs who came and blew out and embarrassed Phoenix at home, the number one seed, who for 95% of the season was the number one seed, right? So these are yeah, nobody is an all-star besides Luka Valley, but these are the same players who got him to this point.
It's
so
also
a fan of that narrative when it hits the time.
It's such a lazy narrative too, because nobody in history has done anything without help. So it's like Luka needs help. Well, yeah, so did Jordan and so did LeBron. And like all of these guys needed help. Like nobody's good enough to
Will
their team through this.
I hear y'all. I'm gonna do it. I think what I'm saying when Luka needs help is, because I'm one of those people say he needs help. It's not that he needs help to get out the first round. He's got enough help for the first round. He's got enough help for the second round. He does not have enough help to win a championship.
Who Dirk?
No, it's 100%. It's being proven
who
true.
Dirk win with? No, it's not.
Who did Dirk win with?
Dirk won with Jason Kidd.
Hall of Famer.
Jason Kidd.
Hall of Famer.
38.
Look at the numbers though. That's a like he did. It's a Hall of Fame. That's a Hall of Famer. You're not gonna disrespect a Hall of Famer. That's fine.
I'm gonna disrespect the old
Hall of Famer. That's fine. But you just said disrespect Hall of Famer, so we throw that out. In my opinion, you thought disrespect Hall of Famer.
He had the Matrix Hall of Fame level.
He's still a Hall of Famer. Look at his numbers that year. A Hall of Fame presence means nothing. A Hall of Fame presence means nothing. At point guard.
If you have Vince Carter, is Vince Carter a Hall of Famer?
Absolutely.
So if you've got Vince Carter on the Hall,
this is why this is mute.
Points.
Vince Carter's not playing the same numbers that Jason Kidd was playing. He's not playing the same minutes.
He was not playing in his prime.
He wasn't playing. He wasn't asked to do the same thing.
It wasn't his first stint in Dallas.
What I'm saying is Jason Kidd at that point
had no help,
had more responsibility than a Vince Carter at the end of his rope.
Also, Jason Kidd averaged 33 minutes a game.
Exactly. That means he's viable.
Brunson's averaging 35, 38 minutes.
And ain't never going to see the Hall of Fame. So anyway, like I'm saying.
That's not a bad thing.
He's invalidated a Hall of Famer. What?
No, he wasn't playing at a Hall of Fame level. Two different things.
Bro.
Karl Malone on the Lakers, not playing at a Hall of Fame level. Gary Payton, not playing on a Hall of Fame level on the Lakers. Those are valid statements.
You got me. You got me. Look up the number. He was playing. How many minutes did he was playing the game, Nate?
He was playing 33 minutes. He was averaging 7 points, 8 assists.
Yes.
8 assists.
He was doing what he
Brunson's
needed to
giving
do.
You 20. Then Willie's giving you 22 off the bench.
You're making it as if points are the only thing. We're talking about what they do best. Jason Kidd, what he does best, control the offense, get people in spots. 8 assists a game. Yes. That's not. Yes. That's not Hall of Fame.
Jason Terry was averaging 15 points a game. Yes. Caron Butler was averaging 15 points a game. Yes. Sean Marion was averaging 12.
Yes, you're proving my point.
Our point. I'm saying he has to do more.
These guys played out of their minds this season. This is a good team.
That was enough help to beat the Heatles?
Yes, because they did what they needed to do.
They beat Kobe, too.
At Hall of Fame. They're Hall of Famers.
This is a good team.
That's how little help he had.
I refuse to trash this team.
Yeah, no, this is – you got that day. I'll let you have that one. If you go.
Luka has more help than Dirk did this year.
Yes.
Okay, well, we can
– So you're comparing Boban to Tyson Chandler at 28.
Tyson Chandler ain't no Hall of Famer.
Tyson Chandler's defensive player of the year. He was a defensive player of the year. He was He was running for defensive player of the year.
Still ain't no Hall of Famer.
What does that have to do being defensive player of the year? That's valid in that moment.
That's a great, great year.
It's not about having 10 Hall of Famers on your team. If you get guys at the right time,
he brought up a Hall of Famer who has 7 points
and 8 assists. Eight assists. Jason Kidd was never averaging 30 points. He's an assist. He's a facilitator.
Eight assists a game.
You cannot sneeze at 8 assists a game. Like, that's nothing. Those aren't Vince Carter's 42 years old, averaging 4 points a game. 8 assists in 33 minutes a game, guarding at that size. That's
Brunson and Dinwiddie is giving him more than 15 Caron Butler points and past his prime Jason Kidd.
What? We talking about point? Because if you look,
I'm talking about production, playmaking.
Right.
We're talking about
that Dirk team. We're talking about Matrix, Caron Butler, Tyson Chandler. These people could get stops. Nobody on that team
so
on Dallas.
So can Kleber.
They wasn't stopping nobody.
Yeah, they did. You don't stop a team when you're down 2-0. You don't stop the number one seed without defense. That's not how this works. You got to be able to play offense and defense. We can't act like they did.
And I'm saying the caliber of people that Dirk had are greater than the caliber of people that Luka has right now.
It's So, Damon, seven-game series, this year's Mavs versus the 2010-2011 Mavs. Who wins?
This team.
Okay, well, we can keep going.
That's the answer. Yeah, we can. We definitely
have to. We have to.
I don't know what time.
He's like, he literally just said a team is about to get swept and the West Coast final could beat the team that beat the Eagles. Yeah, we should move on.
That beat LeBron and Kobe in the same year.
Yeah, we have to
same
move
year.
On.
We definitely have to move on.
Damon was talking about Hall of Famers. They beat Dwayne Wade, Chris Bosh, Kobe Bryant, Pau Gasol. Yes.
We have to move on.
They probably beat 10 Hall of Famers on their way to the ring.
Yeah.
What about it?
And you picking this? You're
the
one saying
Hall of
Famers
are so important, and this is the team that took down Hall of Famers.
No, you're not listening. David brought that up because he tried to bring up
this team was they were giant killers.
And we're saying they're giant killers, and you're picking this Dallas team to beat that Dallas team.
You know what I said?
No, that's what Nate asked. I just want to make sure before we go on.
You brought up the fact. Listen carefully, because you wanted to be the one who be the stir the drink. So this is your drink to swallow. You wanted to bring up and say he doesn't have enough help. Nate and I were saying. He has a help, and we're not going to follow this storyline.
Sure.
You brought up Jason.
Oh, no. I wasn't saying he has enough help.
Jumped off that shit.
I know. I was saying it's a lazy thing because nobody really, like barely anybody
Nobody's
has
winning
help.
Without help, yes?
Yeah.
Right. So everybody has to have help.
Yeah, he does not have the help.
You can't fall on the sword that you win two series, number one seed in the Western Conference, and say he has no help. That would be a lie. You don't get this far without having help.
And what did I say? I said the level of help that he has is not championship level of help.
Right, and I would disagree with that.
Yeah, it's no, but you can disagree with the fact is he's not going to win a championship, so it's not championship level of help. This is not championship level of help.
You can have a championship level team and never win a championship.
No, you can't.
You disagree with that?
Yeah.
Y'all would disagree.
Who got a championship? Who got a championship team and got a championship?
You know, Shaq and Kobe played together for 8 seasons, have 3 titles.
Guess what?
So we're saying only 3 seasons out of 8, they were championship level teams. Is that what you're saying?
To win a championship? Yeah. Those 3 seasons, they had enough to win a championship.
Well, then we definitely got to move on with this conversation.
Yeah, because it's a fact. They only had 3 championships with that team.
So that means 3 out of 8 championship level teams? All right.
I want to line up other teams for Damon Slanders.
Nate, let me make sure we're clear. You also agree that Shaq and Kobe only had 3 championship level teams out of 8 seasons.
No, but that era, there's 4 or 5 teams that are a championship caliber team.
Right. So you can have a championship level team and not win the title. Do you agree with that?
I think you can have if you come out of that era with 0 titles, that to me is the impossible thing. If you have a championship caliber team and you have 0 final appearances, and you have 0 championships.
That's not what I'm asking.
Right.
Can you have a championship level team without winning a title?
Without winning in a single year? Sure.
Thank you.
But that's also, there's 4 or 5 teams that are championship
caliber. Absolutely agree.
Team.
The Heatles went to the championship 4 times. People were expecting them to come out 4 out of 4. Not 4, not 5, not 6. But they didn't. And nobody out of those 4 years would say they weren't a championship level team. So you're not going to win the championship every time.
I think Dallas would. They
I
beat
know.
Them.
I just want to line up.
Because they beat them.
Yeah, they did.
Yeah.
I want to line up teams now for Damon to slander.
The Spurs were a championship level team when they lost to the Heatles as well.
Pistons. Does this team beat the Pistons championship teams in the 2000s?
Who?
This Dallas team.
I don't know what y'all you're misconstruing my point. I'm not
I just think
you said it though. You said this Dallas team
is a great team. What are you?
You said this Dallas team would beat Dirk's team. You said that, unless I misheard you. Did you say this Dallas team would beat Dirk's team?
This
did you say that?
Game series.
Did you say
that?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, sure. They could beat this team. Sure. I'm not saying they for no sweep. I'm not saying they won't go 7 games. You have an agent. Let's walk it down. Let's slow it down for the people listening. You have an agent. This is my side, just so we're clear. You have an old, out of his prime Jason Kidd. You have a not. You have an average Caron Butler. You have a good that season. I'll give you very good that season. That season, Tyson Chandler. You have a decent 15-point-a-game Jason Terry. And then you have a 5'5" Jason Barea who's giving you whatever he's giving you. And then, by the grace of goodness, you've got a top 20 player of all time in Dirk Nowitzki, who that was, 2011? So he probably had a few good years. He's probably in his prime, but on the other end, kind of moving in his prime.
He was
32. And then you had a lot great coaching. Carlisle, correct me if I'm wrong, Rick Carlisle, and just several people working hard to get the job done. That's the team. They had one superstar, no other at that moment all-stars. I could be wrong about Chandler, but I don't think he was an all-star. And so they had a lot of role players with a superstar. 2022, you have Luka Doncic, 23, in his prime. You got Brunson, correct me if I'm wrong, giving you 20 points a game. Dinwiddie coming off the bench, giving you 20 points a game, right? You got in the Sun series, they had Bullock and Finney Smith blowing cats out with the three-point shot. Kleber was busting in their face. So you had a team as well, similar. One superstar, no other all-stars. Tim Hardaway Jr. is not even on the roster right now, basically. We ain't going to put him in there. So what I am saying in my conclusion, and we can disagree and move along here, my main point was I think that this team has a legit shot. I would not be surprised if they could, if both are playing their best, beat that 2011 team. I'm not saying that this 2022 is the best team. I think they're the fourth best team in the playoffs. But I am saying it's very comparable to the 2011 team. In conclusion, I do not believe the storyline that he needs help is valid, especially when they're down 3-0.
All right, let me ask this last question, and then we'll move on. Do you think they need to make significant moves in the offseason to be a championship-caliber team next year?
I think if they got them significant, I think they could be – because you get one, if you get Tim Hardaway Jr. back. But I think their biggest weakness now, just looking at, and I only saw them play the Suns and the Warriors, so I ain't seen no regular season Mavs, is that Powell can't be your number one big man. I didn't even know that, to be honest with you. Like, Powell is their starting center, and that, like, you need a stretch, you either need, like, a presence big man. He ain't got to be great. He ain't got to be Cat, Embiid, Jokic, but you can't have Powell as, he could be your seventh man. So, because then Tim Hardaway come back. You got Brunson, Dinwiddie. Could he start? He could, but he could go for six man of the year. So I'm not going to keep talking about it, but I think they are one big piece or just two small pieces away. But, I mean, Doncic is a top, arguably top five player. If you got a top five player, I think, in my opinion, if you have a top five player, I think you're already a playoff contender and strongly a championship contender.
Are you a secret Dallas homer?
Oh, I'm not from Texas.
But I mean, you went to school there. You lived there for a little bit.
A little bit.
There are ties.
There are ties.
I'm not from Texas. I have no relations to Texas.
Influential ties.
Zero relations to Texas.
Okay, I'm just checking.
I don't have a cat, a fish, a dog, and I have no relations to Texas.
You got no family live in Texas?
That's not – I have no relations.
Do you have family that lives in Texas?
I have people who reside in Texas.
That are your family?
I have no relations to the state of Texas.
Where does your mom live?
She resides in the state of Texas.
That is the greatest lawyer move. Do you know anybody who lives in Texas? I know people who reside.
Don't ever put my name close to Texas like that.
Your mom lives in Texas, bro.
Nah, bro. My mom's from Louisiana, Shreveport.
That's it. She lives in Texas. Street. Mm-hmm. You live in Texas.
Family reunions, all the t-shirts, Shreveport. Let's keep it moving. Let's get to the east side in these streets here. Right now, as we're recording this, as we alluded to, 2-1. Miami's up, but right now they're in Boston, and Miami is down big against Boston. It appears, as we record, that it's going to be tied 2-2 going back to Miami. I'll just say my piece here. I said Boston in 7. Lowry was hurt. Jimmy Butler was out second half game 2. Hero didn't play today. Who didn't play? Marcus Smart didn't play today. Like, this series is people getting banged up. I still got Boston in 7. I still think they're just overall the better team. Nate, I'm going to throw it to you first here. Just where you see the series right now, how much or how little did your prediction, is it being swayed or are you still standing strong?
I still have the Heat. Okay. I think this is one of the ugliest series I've seen in a while. Like, that the playoffs have been ugly overall. But yeah, I do not think that the champion is coming out of the East. I don't think either of these teams are good enough to beat the Warriors. And I think this series is just gonna go too long. They're gonna be too banged up. I don't think it's good. I still have the Heat coming out, but it's not like a confident It's a flip of the coin. I picked the Heat because they're the number one seed.
Sure.
They play really well. It's tough saying this as they're down 30 points, but I mean, with the exception of the Celtics shooting out of their minds last game, they played very well defense up to that point. Mm-hmm. And I think that they know, I still trust Spoelstra. So if it really comes down to it, Heat are the number one seed. I trust they have the better coach.
I respect it.
I think Boston, they play defense well, like Miami plays defense well, but offensively, I think they have the better horses between Tatum and Brown. Sometimes you wonder with Miami where the points gonna come from if they don't come from Jimmy. So that question kind of leaves me like Boston can get it done, but like I said, that narrative, like Miami has been there. Like I said this before, Miami's been there. And they got, I would say they maybe had a bigger chip on their shoulder to get back. Their bigger motivation. So, you know, I think both of them going to lose to the Warriors. But if home court advantage goes to Miami, I think Miami still pulls it out.
Yeah, they do have that home court. I think Boston's a bigger threat to the Warriors just because they have more potential offensive firepower. And they have long defenders that can match up better. I mean, the great defense by me, don't get it twisted, but they're just more of a whole team there. I'm intrigued, though. I'm going to have to look at it now because it might not matter. But both Miami and the Warriors were 53-29. So I don't know how many times they played each other and who has the tiebreaker and things of that nature. But that'll be really interesting, which is
well, crazy. Miami's number one seed.
Regardless of record, it just goes C?
I'm pretty sure it's number one seed, right? Huh. Like highest
C. Number one seed, if it alternates every year.
No, this ain't baseball.
No, baseball is whoever wins.
Yeah, so I was doing something frivolous.
It don't even matter because Miami might need, who knows? But it'll be interesting to see big picture. Last thing I'll say about this because it's all coming together, playoffs. Listen, I think since Jordan, I've never really – shout out to huge respect to all the great players since Jordan. But Jordan was really when I started watching sports heavy, right? 90, 91, et cetera. So Jordan was my guy. And in basketball, since I didn't really play basketball, I was a football dude, I didn't really have another guy. Steph has been my guy. Believer, cool dude, love the way he played with joy, et cetera, great ball player. But this championship, this hypothetical fourth championship, post KD, post no finals MVP 2015, which one of the greatest robberies of NBA history. He's my second guy. And I can see how people get into fandom. It's a slippery slope. Because if my guy gets this fourth title, 34 years old, I saw this stat, I really want a stat, but just this tweet about all the greats who've gotten a championship in year 13. This is Steph's year 13. This one, I don't doubt the first one may be the sweetest to him, but as a fan, as a consumer, this one here, post KD would be the sweetest. That's all I wanted to say.
Post KD and the comeback Clay year.
Two years without
Clay. Like the comeback, the year Clay finally comes back.
Come on, man.
So after people counted you out the past couple years and said you couldn't get it done.
Yeah.
So we'll see. So I see how people get caught up. I see how people get caught up.
Very easy.
It's history out here.
Very easy.
What's next?
What is next? That is the hype tournament. We did it, y'all. We made it to the end.
Burr, 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 burr.
The championship of right above it versus Nuck if you buck.
Yeah.
And our winner is
drum roll.
Nuck if
there it is. There it is.
Winning just by 10%, just 55% to 45%.
I knew it would be close.
It was very close. Tough to argue with the results. Different matchups going up to the championship. Sure, you know, we can argue those. Very difficult to argue with the results of Nuck if you buck being the greatest hype song.
Greatest. Listen,
I meant to post it, but there was a video, I think Lil Jon posted, of some small white child. And I guess her mama, did you see it? Her mom was playing Nuck If You Buck. And this no older than 8 year old child is just losing her mind to Nuck If You Buck. And I was, that's when I said, oh, I got this victory. It's intergenerational. It's intergenerational. Like it is, it will be passed down as a hype song. This kid's just running around the house, cleaners, doing something to Nuck If You Buck. Intergenerational.
Yeah, I knew I had a hit. It's tough to argue. I'll be honest, right above it made a lot further than I thought it would. Like I did not know that people who didn't watch Ballers really knew that song.
Oh, I didn't. I had no idea about when I heard Ballers have the theme song, I was like, oh, they got right above it. Like it was, I don't think Ballers was that big, but though.
There's only one episode of Ballers.
It's one of my guilty pleasures. It's just Entourage.
Oh, it was good. I watched all of it. But
is it Sports Entourage?
It's Sports Entourage.
Yeah. Oh, I'll give it a look. I like
was a good, yeah, The Rock is a financial advisor to professional athletes.
It's Miami Vice with football.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's a good time. Good suits, cute women.
I've talked to a friend of the show, Adon, about it a lot. Mm-hmm. And after I watched this, I was like, oh, if Entourage had hit me at the right time, I would have been all in on that show as well.
Yeah. It hit me at the right time.
Entourage a good show?
Apparently it's
nacho cheese sauce.
Yeah.
So it's like, is it
are there
good?
Better cheeses? Sure.
Sure.
Does it get the job done as far as cheese on a nacho chip? Absolutely.
if you want to get a bag of cheap chips and you want to pump fake cheese into it and have a nice night. Sure.
Put some chili on top and you got me, God dog.
Yeah.
That's the thing. That's all I need from shows. Baller is that show.
Baller
is I don't need Dan Levitard has a cameo appearance at like
Denzel's Washington Sun is in that thing.
Yeah.
It's a good time. It's a good time.
Okay. It's a very good time. Well, before we move from these hype songs, I want to ask you this. I feel like our lists were fairly personal. I think we did a good job of not trying to pick winners.
Sure.
We all decided we're going to come into this very honest. The chips lay. What would you say is your number one hype song? And were you made aware of any new hype songs during this journey?
I definitely have listened to, since we started this tourney, I've listened to Dreams and Nightmares more. I've listened to Win more. Those are just two that come to mind without looking at my Spotify playlist. Can we say Spotify? I know we ain't supposed to say Spotify.
We're not supposed to say Spotify.
It's, you know, the whole comedy thing. Are y'all up to date on the comedy now?
I'm aware. Yeah.
Let me
make sure I'm still on it.
So those are two that come to my mind.
I think the one that I had that didn't get far was the I Left It Wet For You. That was but that's always gonna have a that's gonna get played before I go on stage. That's always gonna get played before I get on stage.
It's so bad.
It is. It's not good. I don't children look away, it's not great. But it's gonna get played. Trying to think of one, you know, honestly, right above it was never on mine, but then I remember I go back and I listen to I realized where I was when that was on, and it was a hype song at one point in time for me. So it like reminded me, like, oh no, I used to mess with that one. You definitely used to mess with that one. That was the tail end of Lil Wayne for me.
Okay. That was it.
That was toward the end.
Man, I mean, we didn't talk about Lil Wayne versus Mark Cuban. We didn't put that on the list.
We didn't. But we'll shook hands. They're good now.
Oh, they're good now?
Yeah, they're good.
We got to record twice a week.
Yeah.
I think for me, it was another win. Swoop and KB. Mm. I just don't really listen to Christian rap. So anytime one...
People sleeping on KB, fam. KB
they are. Legal. But like anytime, like, I don't know. I feel very like disrespectful because I'm always like, oh, that one's actually good. And it's just like, I was just raised on such terrible Christian music. That in my mind, it's like it's very tough to fight that.
You're behind the times.
I am. It's tough to fight that stigma.
I respect it. I respect the self-awareness. KB, one of the best lyricists I put against anybody.
Yeah.
Real quick, before we move on from this one here, I want to shout out everybody voting on these annual tournaments here. But if we even go more niche instead of a song, if you're choosing one verse – pull out one verse, the most hyped verse out of your songs or somebody else's songs, what verse would you say, yo, this verse right here, just give me this for 90 seconds. Give me these 16 bars.
Oh, easy. Gunplay's verse on Power Circle. Gunplay's verse on Power. No one knows what that is. Listen to this, like I can see, but that one right there, I yell that in the car. People look at me like I'm a madman.
It's
all on me now. As you can see now, I'm gonna get this money, and I will not be denied. Be no, it's a long time. Time to pee now. Thought I finished first, they hate me worse. Starting to see now. I'm at the round table. Where your seat at? Where your plate? Where your lobster? Where your sea bass? All right, I'm gonna stop. I'll be rapping that like it's my life dependent on it.
Keep going, because I gotta find mine.
I'm done. I'm done. I gave you too much of my time.
You know, my favorite rapper. I don't know why. Yeah, he's not. I don't think he's the best rapper, but he's my favorite rapper. We talked about the difference between those words.
Mm-hmm.
It's Ludacris. And so just, you know, I'm So Hood on his verse on I'm So Remix. It just gets me every time. I just I'm a fan of his rap, his style. He changed it up. Like when you can rap Llama Llama and then, you know what I'm saying, move, get out the way, the versatility never stops to amaze me. Red Pajama Llama Llama, where your mama? And so that's probably one of my most hyped verses. What you got, Nate?
Look, I'm gonna be very honest with y'all. It's not impressive, it's not cool. It's at the very end of Defying Gravity. Everyone deserves a chance to fly. And if I'm flying solo, at least I'm flying free.
Woo.
To those who ground me, take a message back from me.
Come on.
Tell them I'm defying gravity. And nobody in all of Oz, no wizard that there is or was, is ever going to bring me down. What? It's going after mythical creatures.
What is this again?
It's from Wicked.
Okay.
Every time. I get chills every time. It's so
like
good.
He was quoting some Shakespeare or something.
It might be. It's that good.
I don't think Shakespeare is that good, but okay.
Hot take, y'all. David, what do you think? Shakespeare sucks.
Shakespeare could have been better. No.
Let's try to get Billy on the show. See if he can respond. Y'all tweet at Shakespeare and let him know.
Shakespeare, let him know.
David Perdue thinks he's.
Thought he came a little weak.
Most beginning people suck at most things. Right. There probably were six better black Shakespeares that never got a chance. So we just have to deal with Romeo and Juliet.
You don't know about black Shakespeare?
I don't know about black Shakespeare.
No, I'm saying. I'm like
actually, Shakespeare was historically black. He and Beethoven were friends.
him and Babe Ruth, they hung out at the.
They did. Kevin Quiet. All right.
Let's go. Next topic out of here. Let's keep it popping here. So, a couple things here. Real quick, going back to the NBA, but on the fan side, good thread on Twitter popped off. I'm going to read it just to give some context. It said, I have no way of knowing how much fans sway a game. They sway a game to a degree, I feel. But I say it really sucks that Dallas priced out his good fan. First two series against Utah, against Phoenix, people barely sat down. It was loud. Tonight, he's talking about when they played game three against Golden State, was bad. Definitely not why Dallas lost, but still not great. He's like, somebody else goes on, similar to the Cowboys games, Cowboy games. The average fan can't afford it, especially anything near the field or the court. So, you know, it goes on and talks about that. A lot of fans go, I'm not going to read the whole thread. Yeah, I can't justify $350 for nosebleeds, a lot more of wine, cheese, clientele, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm going to start with you, Nate, here. How much or how little? Business, consumer, where's that balance? Where's that line of pricing out fans in general, or even specifically since we're in this playoff world, especially during when you say home court advantage, home field advantage, you want that noise, you want that excitement, you want that momentum. So how much and where's that fine line?
I don't know where the fine line is. I've only attended one playoff game in my life.
Okay.
It's not something that I pursue. The ticket prices are higher.
Yeah.
It is tougher to get to. Yeah. I just like the NBA has had so many issues with fans this year. I don't know if you're pricing the wrong ones out or if you need to be selective about the ones you bring in. because we've had issues with people. Because you say like all these fans are that aren't able to afford tickets and stuff. I don't necessarily think that is the issue. I think the issue is the people that are sitting in those first five rows are getting in fights with players, are harassing them. That to me is a much bigger issue than can you fill out the rest of the seats. But I get why it goes up. These games are more important. So logically, it makes sense that it would be more expensive. But I don't. It's also it's a bit of an excuse. I don't think the crowd matters as much as home court advantage is. I slept in my bed last night. I hung out with my family. I ate breakfast out of my cereal bowl. I think the comfort of it plays into it much more than just in-game crowd noise.
Dean David?
I did think it's interesting to think about like how you're probably not getting the same fans in the playoffs that you were getting in the regular season where you were gaining that home court advantage. I will say this. Most of the people that are getting kicked out of the games are sitting close to the players. You know, so all the crazy stuff we're hearing is coming from people who are very close to the players. That being said, it absolutely is happening in the cheaper seats. You just can't hear it. There's no way that's not happening up there, too. We just don't hear it. And they don't have access to things to throw at the players because the stuff to throw doesn't reach them. Everybody knows that. So I just think it's an intense time. But it did kind of raise a question, like, are these not the same fans that you had all year? Probably not. It's probably people buying out suites and buying out tickets to like show off to clients and stuff like that. And it's probably people not as invested in the team. Some of them are obviously, but sure, like sure. The fact that like, 2 Chainz and, you know, there's all these celebrities in the front row. It's like, we know that's not his team.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, We know this is not these teams. They're just there to like watch it for the spectacle. So it's probably a little different environment for sure.
Yeah, a couple things real quick. I think one, make your money outside of business. But just as a pound for pound, I think not a big fan of pricing. I do shout out to Arthur Blank and the $3 hot dogs. I think there's something that you get my bonus points for thinking about the year-round consumer experience. If I gave you $67 times 4 in the regular season, I would hope that you could be conscious of that I could afford 122 times 4 instead of trying to afford $478 times 4 when the playoff games come. Because I was there when we played Orlando in November, so please give me a shot. An attempt to be there in round 3 at an even higher price, but a respectable price. That's one. Two, I think your point about the comfort is valid, but I think too many players talked about the fans in the bubble that we can't disrespect its importance. I would give you 60-40 tops, and I'm being kind, but I really think it's 60-40 the other way, where the fans, the noise. Yeah, I don't necessarily need you to spell defense, but all those extra momentum pushes that the bubble didn't have, that so many players did talk about in the moment, in hindsight, I think we can't take that for granted. So
do you think ticket prices should stay the same into the playoffs?
I think they should go up a bit. I think, though, if I'm an owner, I'm conscious of the fact that you helped me make money for 82 games when I had 14 teams who were trash, when I had Tuesday 7:30 games. You know what I'm saying? So I'm conscious of that as an owner. So I want to, yeah, I'm going to raise it up. That's valid. I hear that. I'm not a fool. But I'm also conscious of you pulling up with your little boy on Saturday at 2:30 against the Hornets as well.
The other thing I would say, and this flips it back to the teams a little bit, if you want fans in there, don't lose playoff games by 30 to 50 points. Like, if I was a Suns fan and I had spent $200 to get into that building to have a couple drinks and they lose a game 7 by 50, I don't know if I'm able to trust you again in an elimination game situation.
Oh, listen, let's be clear. The working class and middle class people who out here check the check, working hard, that's the real right there. You know what I'm saying? I might give you one Falcons game because, somebody got a bonus, but I'm not trying to go watch you get blown out by Tampa Bay
and be sad in the second quarter?
Definitely not.
These are valid points.
Yeah. I'm not paying $80 to watch Mariota. I hope he does well. I'm rooting for him, but it's just I'm not spending the financial.
Bro, nobody's spending money on 5 or 6 years. Them things about to be free.
Look, you hear me? Here's the thing. I looked up season tickets because I was like, if I'm going to get them. But I'm like, if I'm going to get them, now's the time to get them.
Sure.
Like,
sure.
Hopefully, the Falcons will never be worse as a franchise than they are right now for the next season or two. And who knows? Ritter might be better than we think. But it was still like $60 a seat per game.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Does that make sense? But to me, it's like you should be begging me. Like I know the product you're about to put on the field.
Hey, man, they got to keep them lights on, man. That stadium opens and closes. You hear me? It opens and closes.
Let Atlanta United.
That's the scoreboard. Look, they had
Atlanta United and Kanye concerts keep the lights on. Like,
we want Falcons, all the money.
You should be, like, tricking people into that. You should be setting up, like look under your chair day. Like, you should be doing anything.
They will, just not right now. Right now, they got to see who will buy it. And around the season start, bro, I promise you, it's going to be like coupons on Sunday. Oh, Falcons tickets again. You're just going to get rid of them.
All right. Well, y'all let me know if you want to go in on season tickets.
I don't. Split them up. Do not want to watch that team. I got better things to do on Sunday. And that's anything else.
That's anything else. That's 4 hours of my day gone.
To get stuck in that traffic and around them people to watch that team, you tripping.
The Marta goes right up to the entrance, basically.
I would rather
still too much work.
Go hang out with y'all at a random bar, eat $12 wings, and drive in that traffic.
Yes.
All right, next topic. Let's jump back into the NBA for a bit. So, J.J. Redick, who is either the best or worst thing to happen to ESPN.
Top
maybe the
right
best
now.
For him. I don't think he's going to last on ESPN. It feels like we live in like one of those like dangerous dictatorships where like we see somebody speaking out and we're just like, they're going to mysteriously disappear. Like, J.J. Redick is about to mysteriously disappear from ESPN. But he basically started a crusade against Bob Cousy.
Bob Cousy.
Cousy.
How you not know your heroes?
Cousy?
He did.
What?
Bro.
It's because, bro. I have to remind myself, I have read it more than I have heard it. So.
That'd be like me saying Wilt Chamberlain.
Okay. You're
supposed to know your people, man.
All right. We'll get to that. So basically,
Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. What are you doing?
Moses Malone.
Michael Jordash. Like,
what?
You're supposed to know your people, man.
Shaquille O'Neal. What the? What is this man?
I got Bob, right?
Yeah, I hope so. Good God.
What all right. The world?
Labrin. You know, like Labrin. Labrin.
LeBron James.
LeBron. LeBron.
So basically, J.J. Redick said Bob Cousy was playing against plumbers and firemen. And old Bobby C. was not a huge fan of that.
Bobby
firing
C.
back, saying, I guess Wilt Chamberlain must have fought fires as well. Two things about this, and then I'll pass it on. One, I forget how young the NBA is.
Mm.
Because I mean, we talked about it. We're like, it's younger than our grandparents.
Mm-hmm.
Like, our grandparents lived a significant portion of their life
pre-NBA. Yeah.
No NBA. So when I saw that Bob Cousy fired back, I was like, "Oh, he's still alive."
Same thought, bro. Same thought. Like, I was like, I didn't even know
Cousy was dead.
Not just still alive, paying attention.
Yeah.
Like, not just like in a nursing home somewhere.
Nah, big dude, chilling.
I did not realize that at all. So good for him for sticking around. I think it's so tricky, and I well, look, we do this a lot because we're in this
we
position.
Do it a lot. We do it.
It's so tricky to compare eras because they're just not the same. The rules are different. The talent is different. I mean, we talk about it in baseball, like some of the quote greatest players of all time never faced anybody black. So it is very difficult to compare these stats to those eras. I don't even know if they played four quarters in the same amount of time. I know they didn't have a three-point line. So there's little stuff like that. But I think you should have to have some awareness that the league you played in does not have the depth of talent that it does today. That as you, and you can, I think it's fine for him to go, I'm part of the reason the NBA continued to become popular and continue to grow. But I think it's dumb to think that not everybody you played against would have made it on a roster in today's NBA. Not saying he wouldn't, but I get the Kuzi hate.
I'm going to say something that nobody going to say. When J.J. Redick was talking about plumbers and that, he was talking about you, Bob Cousy. He wasn't talking about Will Chamberlain. He wasn't talking about Bill Russell. He wasn't talking about these. Imagine Will Chamberlain coming in like, oh, I got to fix your pipes. I mean, he said that, I'm pretty sure, thousands of times, amount of time. But he wasn't talking about leaking. Anyway.
He definitely laid pipe.
He definitely laid pipe. But no, he was talking about you, Bob Cousy, you short people. You people dribbling like this, like you playing the bongos. He's talking about y'all. He's talking about them people that look like him. He wasn't talking about them black players who was playing for their life, who was like four sport athletes who just happened to play basketball. He was talking about you, Bob, so you could get mad, but he was talking about you. He wasn't talking about Will. He wasn't talking about Bill Russell or Kareem.
Yeah.
They're not plumbers. But if there was no basketball, there's something else where height is important. You, Bob Cousy, if basketball don't exist, you are a plumber or a car salesman. You are. No disrespect, but just know what's up.
Yeah. Be appreciative.
Yeah, man. Also, I'm glad you're alive, bro. Very glad you're alive. Didn't know. Yeah, didn't glad, know that
you're alive, glad you're alive. Bob Cousy. Bobby Bob.
What do you call him? Cousy?
Cousy. It's a bad habit.
Bob Cousy.
Bob Cousy.
Hilarious.
Damon, do you have any thoughts?
Nope, no thoughts. Next topic. You know what it is. This is what I got thoughts on. Your grandma's favorite topic, people. It's Nate Hayes. Nate, talk to the people. What we're hanging on this week.
All right, let's do a real personal one. We'll give a bit of an update. After Mother's Day, my family dog is supposed to be put down.
Supposed to be gone.
This is a dog that I mourned. This is a dog that I processed. And my sister's birthday, we celebrated it yesterday. And guess who greeted me at the door? Lady.
I'm a live dog.
The blind, deaf, tumor-infested dog that can't even stand up on her own is still just trucking about. And here's the thing, and maybe y'all can help me process this. I turned into the bad guy for being cold to this dog. Because my mom was like, you have more time than you thought.
To do what?
And I was like, what do you want me to do? You want me to process this? Like, you want me to reopen that womb? Not just reopen a womb. Like, as much as I love dogs, they're dogs. Like, the womb healed. Like, it's so what you saw, it's not even ripping the Band-Aid off. It is ripping the Band-Aid off, finding the scar, opening that back up. Like, it's not even a scab. So I was like, I can't do anything about it. And then it was just hours of this dog hitting my leg, licking me, sniffing me, and I cannot look at her.
Because it's dead to you.
Because in my mind, I'm like, it's a ghost.
It's a ghost dog.
And it's a ghost dog. Do not look at that ghost dog.
Sound like a CBS show. Ghost Dog.
Ghost Dog.
Ghost Dog. Starring Pete Holmes.
I do want to talk about that. So maybe when Nate hates just talking about Pete Holmes.
What's that, Ghost Dog?
Have you seen Pete Holmes' CBS show?
No, it's canceled.
I have.
He's a professional bowler. And
it's
look,
canceled.
It's the most Pete Holmes has ever been. This is more Pete Holmes than when he played Pete Holmes in Crashing.
Probably.
Like him as a professional bowler with a laugh track. It's not good, but it's beautiful.
Sure, I bet.
Okay. So here's my hate. If you're a parent out there, just kill things you say you're gonna kill.
Ooh.
Don't illegal stuff. Don't do that. Don't murder. But look, if you tell your kids, hey, I think your goldfish is about to die tomorrow. You just got to flush that goldfish. Stop painting yourself into a corner. You're a parent. Be more responsible than that. And then if your kid calls you out, on your irresponsibility and maybe what you put them through. Do not then flip it and guilt trip them back and say that, I don't know, maybe you just loved this dog or that it's a tough thing. Yeah, it's a tough thing to do. No, nobody likes to put down dogs.
Mm-mm.
Nobody's thrilled about that. Nobody's like, nobody. I can't wait. Saw my dog defecate on itself. Great. Time to go.
Is that happening to the dog?
They claim, and this is the thing, I don't believe them. I don't believe they claim that she's fine.
Mm.
My little brother used the term frolic. He said she frolicked in the yard the next day.
Mm.
I said, that dog has not frolicked since pre-Trump. That is the last time that dog frolicked was when Obama was in office. So, no, I do not believe for a second that dog frolicked. And so that's the thing. I don't believe him anymore. And I don't know. I do not think they will ever put that dog down.
Mm.
I think I will get a call from my dad to help me move a body. I think that's what's going to happen.
Yeah. Don't they know that's the worst option is waking up and you trip over the dog because it died on the steps.
Right. And now you got to figure out what to do with it.
Yeah.
We don't like, and this is a big dog. This isn't a shoebox dog.
Not a little dog.
This is a border collie.
Mm.
It is a substantial, it's not a huge dog, but it is substantial. Not only that, job. My little brother is leaving to go to Bulgaria for a couple weeks on Wednesday.
What?
So,
that was.
So it's up to me now. I am, my sister's
no,
up there.
No, it's not.
I'm stuck with it. I know I'm going to get the call. I know I'm going to get the call from either my dad saying, hey, come help me move this body, or my mom saying, hey, come help me move this body before your dad gets home.
You know what you
I'm
say?
Get one of those two.
Mom or dad, I can't help move a ghost. That dog has been dead.
I just appreciate you thinking you're going to pick up every call. Y'all are sweet kids.
Yeah.
You gotta pick up the call. If you don't pick up the call, you get the text, then the call again. So you just got to like...
Mama, I'll be like, who are you talking to? This is Katoya. Who are you talking to? I'm talking to your mom. Oh, yeah, I forgot to call her back. I'm not the best, guys. I have weaknesses.
I will say that's why I put my mom and my wife on a group chat. So that's what my mom uses to communicate with me. So therefore, it's on Libby's radar as well.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
My Katoya came the other day. She was like, yeah, are you excited about your mom's new job? I was like, what?
Wow, bro.
What? What? New job? When was she having conflict at the last job?
Oh, my God.
That kind of stuff happens to me all the time. Nobody tells me anything. Well,
my mom stopped trying to tell me things. That's different.
That's a whole new level. They're like, this ain't going to do no good. I ain't even going to try.
Well, then I brought it up, and now my family is like overcorrecting and like telling me too much. And I'm like, no, I just need important stuff.
That's it.
Yeah.
Like when you're going to kill this dog.
Yes. And man, don't you go here and bury that dog. They got to learn that lesson. They should have killed it when they said he was going to kill it. Don't you go up there and don't you drive an hour to bury your childhood dog.
Won't you just drive up there right now and poison the dog?
Still the same situation.
Bro, if you was a real one, when you was up there, your dog gonna be there for your sister's birthday. Man, you drop a little. What's dogs not? What are they not supposed to eat? Chocolate?
They like antifreeze.
What? I was trying to give it something respectable.
Whoa!
No, I've heard there's a couple guys that I used to work with at ASA.
You mean a couple psychopaths you used to work with? Continue.
Psychopaths. Antifreeze. They say that it's got a sweet taste, and they say dogs lap it up, and then they get like a real
man. Real check high on energy. These. People's wives, they have killed them. I'm sure.
No, they got toes in jars.
Yeah, they got basements full of bodies.
No. Antifreeze.
Thank goodness you found us. You used to hang around with
whole
murderers.
Like I said, there's an earth to Nathan that is dead, unhappier. But
Damon, do you know how to kill anything? Just like, like I thought about this is the way you kill things.
But I was gonna get that dog a Kit Kat. That's all I was gonna plan to do.
Yeah, I knew about chocolate. I thought I wasn't even sure about that.
This man said also, a radiator.
Apparently.
Yeah, go look on that radiator.
Wow. Also, apparently chocolate isn't even that big of a deal.
I've been lied to.
But your dog sounds sick enough where it's a big enough deal.
Well, no, my current dog, Peggy, she ate a bunch of chocolate chip cookies that we had cooling on the counter. And then so I had to look it up and they were
Damon. Yeah, we gotta acknowledge David gave the timeout signal. Go ahead, Damon.
To be clear, when you say counter, the counter is knee level.
No,
the counter is
next to the stove.
This dog is tall enough to be on hind legs and eat this food.
Oh yeah, easy.
Easy.
You've seen my dog.
We seen it up close.
Yeah, I mean, but you've seen pictures of her. Like,
you don't know. I didn't. This is my first time realizing.
I've seen a picture of a dinosaur. That don't mean anything.
But you've seen me with this dog.
I ain't seen it. I ain't know it was this tall.
I ain't never seen your dog in real life.
She's not even that tall. She's
bro, you talking about get up to a counter? That's tall enough.
She's maybe knee high.
Nah, bro. She's counter. She's grabbed cookies off the counter tall. We know this now.
I mean, if she jumps, if I tell her to like jump on my chest, her paws come up to like
your chest, right?
Yeah, my chest. She can put her paws on my chest.
She can eat cookies off the counter.
The counter. Where's she in your kitchen? We don't have time. We gotta get out of here.
Anyway, so I had to look up how dangerous dog chocolate is. And basically, if they eat an ounce, if they eat more than an ounce per pound, they weigh. So my dog, who weighs 60 pounds, she'd have to eat like 2 bags of chocolate chips before it was even like close to being a problem.
Oh, I've been lied to. I thought one morsel of chocolate was killing.
Let's go take our dogs.
I did too. I've yelled at so many dogs, like dropping something on the ground. Yeah. I pulled it out of mouths, and I could have just been like,
"Dog, was like, let me get a taste."
Yeah.
Come on now, let me get in on that.
How many cookies was on this counter, fam?
Yeah, we got to talk about this real quick.
It was a lot. I was very upset.
You lost a dozen of cookies.
We probably lost 6 or 7.
You lost all of them because that little dirty mouth.
No, that's the thing. We ultimately threw them all away because we're like, we don't know what she hit. We know the ones that she ate. We don't know other ones that she...
Yeah, she had touched her anus and then been all in the dirt and then come over here. And put her dirty, stinky tongue on my counter.
Do you now wonder what else she licks on your counter that you leave there?
No, she only goes
you
for,
should.
She only goes for food.
No.
That you know. You don't know what that dog is.
This is a wild beast.
One of us has an eye on her most of the day.
That dog ate 7 whole cookies. Nobody paid attention to that dog.
We were getting ready to leave.
If that dog can eat 7 whole cookies, y'all are not watching. Y'all are negligent.
Libby was getting ready. Dog, I had to go to the bathroom. I came back out. She's on the counter.
That dog is running that house because it's not paying it being paid attention to.
That dog licked her vagina 2 times and said, cookie time. And
it was a brief lapse.
Just know you've eaten things. You've eaten things that dog has been like, I don't want that after it licked on it. Just know you've eaten that.
We've addressed it.
You have eaten those things. I don't know what they are. Just like that random fact, we've all eaten bugs. You know what I'm saying? Your random fact is you've eaten some of your dog's leftovers. You just didn't know.
He ate 3 giant cookies. He don't want to say he ate them all the way. He ate those cookies.
He ate a giant cookie, dog.
No, the cookies were gone. Let the record show. We threw out all the cookies.
You think that's the first time your dog has had a cookie that you left out?
She's never not been caught.
That you know of.
We don't have a massive house. We can hear the kitchen from wherever we are.
Yeah, okay.
She's not a stealthy dog.
Okay. Ate 7 cookies worth.
You go to the bathroom every day. What is man thinking?
And no one else, stop eating the cookies. That means that dog knows when y'all not paying attention.
What type of discipline action did you take?
She got yelled at, she got popped in the snout, and she got put in the crate.
Popped in the snout.
Dog giggling the whole time, like y'all gonna eat them giant cookies, dog. I win. Popped in the snout. No, you think you can cage me?
No, you don't feed that dog for 48 hours. You can tell who's boss. What's wrong with you, man?
That dog's not gonna eat me. I'm not doing. We're not going down that road.
No, I didn't say.
No, he didn't say that.
Eat you? I didn't say that at all.
He said don't feed it for 48 hours. Which I'm like, I don't know if you can do that or say.
Yeah,
it
feels
on
like abuse.
You just said pop a dog on the snout. What do you think physical abuse is?
You give him a pop on the snout.
No, you don't pop dogs on the mouth. He's a live living thing.
Do you spank your kids?
No.
Y'all don't spank?
No.
You gotta talk about that sometime. I guess it's fine.
No, it's not fun. They were doing the best they can, and they did it poorly, just like I'll do my job poorly with no spanking. It's okay. parents are trying their best.
This is a little pop on the snout. She's fine. She just sneezes, moves on. She doesn't care. Next topic, racism.
Let's jump into it.
So Yankees third baseman Josh Donaldson and White Sox shortstop Tim Anderson apparently had an issue where Tim Anderson claimed he made a racist comment. That's all I'm going to say. So this is after they exchanged words because Donaldson called him Jackie, referencing Jackie Robinson. Now, Josh Donaldson's side of the story is that a few years ago, Tim Anderson said he's making baseball fun, that he is the new Jackie Robinson.
Well, he feels like the new Jackie Robinson.
He feels like the new Jackie Robinson. So apparently Josh Donaldson thought it was an inside joke to call him Jackie. And not an inside joke for Tim Anderson. Now, a couple people on Twitter are claiming that it's because Tim Anderson's like the White Sox aren't playing well and it's just a little salty. So there's a couple things that could possibly go into it. Here's what I would say, just my perspective as a white person. Don't make racist jokes to people you are not very, very good friends with. And even then, probably not. Like, I feel like we are all very good friends.
Mm-hmm.
I have never once called you guys like another black comedian.
Nope.
Like, we've never been at a gas station and I'm like, hey, get in the car, Chappelle. We got to get out of here. Like, as good of friends as we are, it would cause hesitation.
On your part, for sure. Believe.
But would it not be weird to y'all if I said that?
Because you've never joked like that, sure. Okay. Would I feel offended? Probably not. Here's
that's
why.
The thing. Like, I don't think what Donaldson said was meant to be racist. I just think he misunderstood how close they are.
No. I want to be very clear about this. This is a great moment, learning moment, I feel, for white people. Unless you know. Black friends, and I say no, they real people, and you've heard they real voice, not they work voice. You heard they real voice, you know, at least one family member, like it's certain they've invited you somewhere where other black people are. You don't know them the way you think you know them. You know the them that they want you to see. Okay, and that is 100% true. Josh Donaldson, and he's a former Brave. I loved him when he was with the team. I thought he brought a lot of excitement to the team. A lot of people that used to play him don't like him. So I know Tim Anderson, who ain't never played with him, don't like him. They ain't got nothing in common. So that whole assumed friendship that he's talking about now, that ain't real. Tim Anderson, to his credit, was like, bro, you don't know me like that, which is something I feel like a lot of black people want to say to white people, but don't have a platform to say. That's why I say this is a beautiful moment, right? This is a beautiful moment. Because, again, there are a lot of white people out here who are on the sound of my voice who assume that they got close, tight friendships with black people, and they do not. You only know your black friend at work. You don't know that man like that. You don't know that man, woman like that. And like I said, until you meet them on their turf and know them on their turf, keep all the inside stuff that you assume to yourself because it's probably not real. Right? Like me and you, Nate, you know my brother. You've met people in my family. I've been to your mom's house. You've been on my turf. Like, you've met people in my family, right? There's a different understanding. Like, if you had an inside joke, I'd be like, bet. There's an understanding. Josh Donaldson, they never played on the same team. They probably don't have the same agent. They ain't been in the same division that often, I don't think. Like, he don't know you like that, man. You're not that likable amongst other people. So, Josh Donaldson, I hear you, but nah, bro, that ain't it. That ain't it, bro.
That ain't it.
That ain't it.
You know, when people throw out jokes, it's all funny until the consequences come out.
Yeah.
And this was a bomb, big dog. Simple as that.
Like, when I first heard it, when Josh Donaldson, I said, oh, he said, because he said, well, I said it back in 2019, right? He said, I said it. He said, I said it back in 2010 after he said it. And he said, and at first I go, dang, if he said it back then and Tim Anderson didn't say nothing, obviously he would think maybe I could say it again. But then you start thinking, whatever context he said it back then wasn't good. They wasn't on the same team. Right. And he probably knew him less then than he know him now.
Right.
So maybe Tim Anderson back then didn't say, hey, bro, stop that because he's focused on the game or whatever's going on. And maybe he was frustrated they were losing. Either way, you don't know this man. You don't know him. Yeah, he's not one of your drinking buddies.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but Anderson's only played for the White Sox, right?
Yes.
And Donaldson, so all the interaction they've had have been on opposite teams.
Yep.
Probably the most interaction they had was when Donaldson was on the Twins.
Probably. Maybe they crossed paths as All-Stars or maybe potentially. I don't know. Maybe.
But yeah, never though, like you said, they were never teammates.
Never.
They were never teammates.
Yeah. Also, so, if you hear both of them talk, they got nothing in common. So it's not like they were sitting around being best friends anywhere after postseason.
No.
Like, yeah, white people, stop assuming friendships. If you don't know your black friend's non-work voice, say them jokes. They don't like you like that. You bothering them. Leave them alone.
This is terrible.
Trying to help y'all out, man.
Man.
Hello there.
All right. Well, there's the sounds.
Oh,
we did it. We made it. I'll be honest. This might be the quickest final finish that we have.
Let's get it.
But that's okay. Welcome. I already named it accidentally. Welcome back to the final finish. This is it. The finality that we have in this show. So, music will start right about now. And 50% of the topics. Apparently, Tom Brady has signed up to be roasted on a Netflix special. Mm. You might think this is something that would be perfect for me, but it's not because roasts are meant to be for people that you respect. So I don't think I would.
Not afraid. Always.
I don't know if
you
I
ever
would.
Seen, you ever seen Hannibal Buress roast Justin Bieber? It's one of my favorite things ever. I don't like you. I don't think your music is good.
I feel like that's what it would turn into if I was on this.
Give me your three best takes.
I mean, I think it would be very simple. Like, it would be very almost like anti-roast stuff. Of like, I don't like who you are as a person. I don't like who you portray yourself in the media. I wish nothing but you to have zero success.
It's too late.
There could be some jokey stuff. Like, I don't know. I know we're the deflated football. Like, I don't know. There's something with plastic surgery.
This man was full under pressure. He would get his one shining moment. And whiff. You hear this, Damon? This is all you live for, dog. I felt like this would be, if you got this, it would be better, greater than Netflix gave you an actual special. You would love this more than that.
That is the thing. If Netflix gave me this, it would be like, I would go to a cabin somewhere. I would treat it like people do for like an album. I would be like, let me be secluded. I'm going to turn my cell phone off. I'm going to take 6 sharpened pencils and a notebook with me. I'm going to be amongst nature. I'm going to listen to the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to write down everything to help vanquish the Lord's enemy. So I think that's the angle I would take.
Okay.
Do y'all have any roast jokes off the top of your head for Brady?
For Tom Brady? Nah, man, I love Tom Brady. I ain't got nothing to say about him.
I ain't got no roast jokes. I just know that people think they like a good roast, and truth be told, they really do not.
That's the thing. I'm also weary.
Everybody ain't built to get roasted.
Tom Brady's a producer on it. So he's not going to let mean jokes. He's going to have a couple. He's going to let a few slide. He's going to let enough slide to where people aren't going to think about it. But there's going to be a lot of jokes that are too true that he's going to leave. I think anything with PEDs, he's going to say you can't say.
I doubt it. He's only producer to make more money. He don't care. You can't hurt him.
I don't think that's true.
You can't hurt him. You think you can say something he has not heard?
Yes.
Please. You really think you can say something that some NFL linebacker that don't his job is to hurt him has not yelled across?
Because he doesn't have to listen to them. That's the thing. He hung up on Boston radio almost monthly because they dared push back.
Yeah,
because
he's at his house. I'm going to hang up with you at my house.
Listen to these local radio interviews. Tom Brady has the emotional capacity of wet paper.
I'm not listening to you yell at me at my house. I'm hanging up too.
That's what he signed up for. He signed up to talk about the game.
And then once you talk,
the game didn't go well, I'm sorry. You still signed up to talk about it.
No, not at my house.
You didn't sign up to talk about the wins only.
I'm not on the field. I'm at my house.
You seen the way he treats his teammates, screaming at guys on the sidelines?
Why they all love him then?
Throwing iPads left and right?
Why they all love him then? Why they all love him then?
He's a child.
Why they all love him then? I just want you to know, you can't think of nothing more hurtful than some linebacker that's been battling him for years.
No, I know that. And honestly, like, roasts hurt people that have souls. So, yes, it will be tough to hurt Tom Brady because I can't do anything the Dark Lord's not going to do when he finally collects his prize. Next topic, Jimbo Fisher and Nick Saban kind of started going back and forth, claiming that Alabama's coach bought all of his recruits. Jimbo Fisher called him a narcissist, basically said he has a God complex. And I don't know, any Division I coach calling out another Division I coach for buying recruits.
Snitch.
I just don't know if you want to do that. I don't know if you want to be the guy that's holier than thou in the SEC.
Definitely.
That's not something I would do. But the God complex stuff with Saban, probably. How many rings does he have? 7?
More than Jimbo.
Listen, that man think he's a lord. You hear me? Lowercase lord in the shire here. And everybody buying. Let's get nothing like it twisted. In some shape, form, or fashion. Everybody buying.
I love how he was like, did y'all know Saban's a narcissist? Duh.
Yes.
Hello. Tell me something you don't know.
The question, why aren't you coach? Narcissists be winning. You better get a little bit out on your team.
Yeah, it's almost like it's more of a red flag if you have almost 10 rings and you're like, oh, who, little old me?
Yeah, we're like, get out of here, you liar. You don't believe that about yourself.
At all.
Yeah.
No, who do you think, though, has the more violations between Nick Saban and Jimbo Fisher?
Nick Saban.
Yeah, no question.
Yeah.
Really?
Nick Saban probably has sheriffs and local judges in the fight.
He absolutely does.
Come on, man. You better watch those out to get your life together.
You think Nick Saban is basically a crime lord?
Yes.
Duh. Next question.
I wouldn't put it past him. That makes sense.
Yeah. And I think nobody in Alabama cares.
No.
No.
Yeah, Nick Saban has put Alabama on the positive side of the map ever. Before Alabama football, and we go back, who was the first great Alabama coach? I can't think of his name.
Bear Bryant.
Thank you. But apart from them two white men, nobody talks highly of Alabama.
That's the only time they talk highly of them is football.
That's it. Nobody.
Now, I give it one caveat. Those beaches are underrated. They need to do some PR on that. Nobody talks about them. But apart from that, nobody talks about anything good about that. So, yes, that man got two sheriffs, a commissioner, Mayor,
you
got all seven people in his pocket, man. Don't get it twisted.
All right, well, there we go.
Bang.
Anything else y'all have on your hearts? Any questions, comments, concerns, unspokens?
Nah, shout out to Cuzzy, though. Shout out to Bob Cuzzy, Nate's great 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 uncle, Bob Cuzzy.
Lebron. Lebron and Karam.
We did it. That's all 10 of our topics. Thank y'all so much for sticking around. We appreciate it. One more time, my name is Nathan Owens. You find me on Twitter, @IAM_Owens. Instagram.
Slow down.
I am Owens. NathanOwensComedy.com. You can watch my special.
Views on YouTube, speeding up.
You can watch my special, Name Brand Human, on YouTube right now, or you can stream it wherever comedy is found.
Yo, follow me on Instagram and Twitter @DoorDie. That's @DueorDie or DavidPurdueComedy.com.
Get at me on Instagram and TikTok, DamoGnJr2. Listen, it's a little bit away, but let's get it popping.
Get it popping.
I'm going to be in Denver for the first time.
Oh, you're going to have a good time.
December, so hike. December 20th through December 30th.
Are you in December? I don't know what type of time.
That's not right at all.
I'm about to say, I don't know what type of time you're going to have out there.
I was looking at the wrong word on my screen.
Yay.
June.
Oh, okay.
June. I was about to say, good luck.
Patrons, get this man a coat.
No. June 20th through June 30th. June 20th through June 30th. Denver. Okay. I got shows on the website, DamonSumner.com. You'll see them as well. So mess with me. Tell your people, Denver, I'm pulling up.
Denver, pull up. I had a couple listeners pull up when I was in Denver. Y'all got to show Damon the same love.
Here we go. #4th10. See y'all next week.
I love
it. Peace.
it's going down. Yeah, well, I'm a cat tone pistol holding nigga on your damn street. Stopping, jumping, bumping, every crunk off in this damn thing. Throwing the balls, I pack these soldiers, screaming and bleeding from their nose. But when we start, that's where we make them niggas hit the flow. Ain't no game off in this thing. We be deep off in your party. Call my niggas, get it started. And with niggas, be the hardest. So if a nigga come and run they mouth just like a hoe, punch him dead up in his nose and stomp his ass out to the flow.
Yeah, we nucky and bucky and ready to fight.
You wasn't wise, I think it's time I knock you, ho.
I come in the club shaking my dreads.